King Saul when I was a kid, going to church as a kid. And if you never heard about King Saul, you're going to learn about him today. But he's often given this bad rap as this guy who really just wild out and did some crazy things. And he did do some crazy things. We're going to talk about some of those today. But there are also some things I want you to understand about King Saul. And I believe there are things that you can extract from his story that you can apply to your personal story, to your journey. In this part one of our series, we've titled it The Consequence of Disobedience. Now, all of us know we grew up with parents or some type of parental guardian. We all know that there are some consequences for disobedient behavior, right? We couldn't just go and do whatever we wanted to do in life. We had to pay attention to the rules that our parents left for us to follow. And if we grew up in certain types of households, there were certain consequences or punishments for certain actions or behaviors. And so the Bible calls God our Heavenly Father, and when he gives us rules and instructions, if we don't follow them, there must be consequences. Can somebody say consequences? Well, the consequences aren't just bad things, although we normally hear that C word in a bad light. Consequences can mean good things. Consequences are the results of. And so if we are obedient, we get some more pleasant consequences that go toward God's lives. And in contrast, if we're disobedient, then we may get some reprimand from God. And so we're going to learn from King Saul today. But before we go any further, I want us to take a look at the focus point. And if you don't remember anything else that we talk about this morning, I want you to remember this. It's going to come on the screen. God's purpose is clear, and I avoid harsh consequence when I submit myself to him through obedience. God's purpose is clear, and I avoid harsh consequence. Somebody say harsh consequence. When I submit myself to him through obedience. Now, the first thing we got to understand before we dig into King Saul's life, we have to know what was happening in the Bible during this time. In the Old Testament, at this point in time, there were no kings in Israel. All God's people had was the heavenly king. They had God. They called him Yahweh. Can y'all say Yahweh? Yahweh is the Hebrew name of our God. And so the Israelites called God Yahweh, and Yahweh was their king. But the issue was, is that God wanted to be their king, but they wanted a man to rule them. I'll say that again. God wanted to be their king, but they wanted a man to rule them. Let me make it more practical. God wants your attention, but you want some man or some woman to get all your attention. And so what we can learn from King Saul right off the bat is that the people of Israel had the all-powerful God giving them instructions through his prophets, through his men of God, but they said, nah, we want to be like everybody else. Let's look at 1 Samuel chapter 8, verse 4 through 9. Finally, all the elders of Israel met at Ramah to discuss the matter with Samuel. Look, they told him, you are now old and your sons are not like you. Let's talk about Samuel for a moment. Samuel was a judge and a prophet of the people. So he was the judge. He was the one that told them God's law, and he heard from God. Like a cell phone gets a signal from the satellite, he would get the signal from God and speak it to the people as a prophet. But they said, hey, man, you're getting old, man. We're tired of hearing from God through your mouth, man. Look at what they said. Give us a king to judge us like all the other nations have. The key phrase in that verse is, like all the other. If your parents were like my parents, they tried to encourage you to not do what everybody else was doing. Did you all hear the old phrase from your parents like I did? If all your friends jumped off the bridge, you would what? Jump off the bridge too, right? Why do parents use that one? Maybe I won't. I hope I won't use it with my kids. But they wanted to be like all the other nations so bad. So let's see what happens in the scriptures. Verse 6, Samuel was displeased with their request and went to the Lord for guidance. For everything they say to you, I'm sorry, do everything they say to you, the Lord replied, for they are rejecting me, not you. They don't want me to be their king any longer. Ever since I brought them from Egypt, they have continually abandoned me and followed other gods. Somebody say continually. Ray, turn me down some. I'm getting feedback as I move around. Thank you. Continually abandoned me and followed other gods. What I want you to understand is that God doesn't like to play seconds. God wants to be your focus. God wants to be the main thing, center of attention, the main attraction in your life and your heart. And if you have other people, places, or things that are more priority, God gets jealous. Somebody say jealous. God said the people of God continually abandoned him to follow other gods. And now they're giving you the same treatment. Verse 9, do as they ask, but solemnly warn them about the way a king will reign over them. He said, warn them about the way a king will reign over them. We're going to have six lessons today. Here's lesson number one if you're taking notes. Lesson number one is, I should never want what I want more than what God wants. We phrase that kind of tricky on purpose because I want you to remember it. Let's look at it again. I should never want what I want more than what God wants. See, they wanted a king, but they already had the King of Kings. Huh? They wanted a man to lead them, but they already had the God-man leading them. Sometimes we can have things going on in our lives that we don't like, and we tell God, we tell our parents, we tell our supervisor, we tell our boss, we tell whoever, I'm going to go over here and do this. It's got to be better over here than it is over there. But how many of you all know, like I know, sometimes you think the grass is greener on the other side, and that grass be brown as I don't know what. Right? You go out of this relationship, and you get to this one thinking it's going to be better. And you're like, man, I should have stayed with Junebug. Like, it's something about us thinking that there are the trends of society that we need to follow in order to get what we think we need. Some of us have jobs that pay well, but we say, man, I'm content here. I enjoy going to work, but I'm not making as much money as they are. I want to go over here and make more money, but I'll be miserable making more money. See, sometimes we have to think about the trade-off. And so if we want something more than what God wants for us, we have to remember that that thing might become an idol in our hearts if we're not careful. So the first lesson we can learn from this fallen king is what the people should have learned. They should never want what they want more than what God wants. Let's get back to the scriptures. 1 Samuel chapter 8, verse 18. When that day comes, you will beg for relief from this king you are demanding, but then the Lord will not help you. But the people refused to listen to Samuel's warning. Even so, we still want a king, they said. We want to be like the nations around us. We want to be just like everybody else. I want to have a house like they got a house. I want to have a husband like her husband. I don't like my husband. I want a wife like her, man. Yo, his wife is way better than mine. I need kids like their kids, right? That's called coveting. That's a sin called coveting, when you want what somebody else has instead of being thankful for what you got. So they said, we want to be like everybody else. We want to be like all the other nations around us. Our king will judge us and lead us into battle. But what y'all got to understand is that God was fighting battles for them. If you look in the Old Testament, you'll see the Lord would bring confusion upon the camp of their enemies and make their enemies start slaughtering each other. Like, this invisible God was literally fighting for them, sent a plague to destroy Egypt. Like, this God was all that. This invisible superhero God was all leading them into battle, but they wanted to be like everybody else. Have you ever found yourself saying that to God? I want to be like them. When I was a kid growing up, there was a commercial. Like Mike. If I could be like Mike. And it was like, I want to be like Mike. And it was this woman singing with her heart out about being just like Michael Jordan. Now, I never learned to play basketball, although I have beaten some of you in basketball, Jaden. Okay, but for the most part, I'm not good at it. But I learned that there are ways that we can be advertised to be like. Like moths to a flame, drawn in. If I could just emulate these people, then my life would be better. And God says you need to be mindful that you got something great, which is why we need to remember our focus point for today. If we don't remember anything else, I want you to remember our focus point for today, which is God's purpose is clear, and I avoid a harsh consequence when I submit myself to him through what, church? Obedience. Let's go back to 1 Samuel chapter 8, verse 21. So Samuel repeated to the Lord what the people had said, and the Lord replied, do as they say and give them a king. Then Samuel agreed and sent the people home. Lesson number two, if you're taking notes. We got six lessons today. Lesson number two is this. Just because the people around me are doing it doesn't mean I should be doing it. Right? Just because it's what's popular or trending. Now, a lot of us in here are adults, and we say, oh, you know, Pastor Devin, I'm not in high school, man. I got some cool high school and middle school students in here, though. And you may say, well, Pastor Devin, this is a message more so for adolescents. They follow the trends. Well, if you're not too careful, you can find yourself trying to emulate and be like other people, even as an adult. It's not some adolescent thing. It's a human thing. It's a human complex because we often want to be like what we see. And we often are not content with what we've been given. And so lesson number two is just because the people around me are doing it doesn't mean I should be doing it. Let's go to 1 Samuel chapter 9, verse 20. 20C, the third part of verse 20. Here's what the scripture says. And I am here to tell you that you and your family are the focus of all Israel's hopes. This is Samuel now talking to this guy named Saul. Here we go. Here's Saul. God has spoken to the prophet Samuel and told him that there's this 30-year-old man named Saul who's going to be the first king in history to lead the people of Israel. So when Samuel talks to this guy, Saul, he tells Saul, I am here to tell you that you and your family are the focus of all Israel's hopes. That's the problem. You might look at that verse and say, yeah, man. Saul might get pumped. I'm the focus of all of Israel's hopes. But the problem is when you put all your hope on a human, when you put all your hope on a man, when you put all your chips on a woman, when you put all of your life's effort and focus and energy into a relationship, some of y'all are so quiet because you've done it, and I feel your pain. You invested time, energy, money, emotional weight into a job, into a man, into a woman, into some friendship circles that turned out to be nothing. Nothing. Credit card bills are still maxed out, paying off stuff that you did with people you don't even hang with anymore. This was the warning that God gave the people of Israel. He told the prophet Samuel, warn them about the king that will reign over them. Here's the warning, and he's telling it to the guy who's going to be the king. The problem is you and your family are the focus of all of Israel's hopes. When they should be focused on God, in God's will for their lives, they want to be like everybody else. They want to be like all the other nations. They want to be like everybody else. We want a king too. Could that have been maybe your mantra at some point in your life where God was telling you, I'm all you need, and you said, I hear that, God, but I need to smoke this too. I hear that, God, but I need to get drunk on a regular basis because instead of trusting you to help me focus on my life's problems and process, I need this liquid courage. I need these friendship circles. I need to work this job. Some of us are slaves to our jobs. Our children don't see us. Our families don't see us. Our spouses, our parents don't see us because we spend so much time working and making this idol in our hearts that becomes the focus of all our hopes. When God says, I'm a jealous God, I should be the focus of your hopes. Having a man is not a sin. Having a woman is not a sin. Having kids is not a sin. Having a job is not a sin. But it becomes sinful when you put that before the Lord. Let's get back to the scriptures. Right here, 1 Samuel chapter 9, verse 21. Saul replied, but I'm only from the tribe of Benjamin, the smallest tribe in Israel. And my family is the least important of all the families of that tribe. Why are you talking like this to me? Here's something that positive we can get from Saul's life. Lesson number three, if you're taking notes. God likes to use unqualified and unlikely candidates like me to accomplish his purposes on the earth. God likes to use unqualified and unlikely candidates like me to accomplish his purposes on the earth. Maybe you've had a Saul moment, a verse 21 moment, where God has told you that you are supposed to do something. You're supposed to fulfill this plan for God, and you're like, you want to use me? Let's go back to verse 21 real quick. He says, yo, I'm from the smallest tribe in Israel, and my family is the wackest. We're the least important. We're nobodies. Why would God want to use me? And so this is to encourage you all, if you've ever, ever, ever had that negative self-talk, right? God, why would you want to pick me? God, how can I do that? Saul had this complex at first, but you're going to see in a few moments that he soon got over that complex and went in a totally negative direction. I'm not telling you to emulate Saul from that standpoint, but I do want you to take notice of what Saul says here in verse 21, that God will call you even if you are not qualified to do some things, because he wants to get the glory where people will say, that must be God, because I know she ain't have the credentials. That must be God, because he ain't got enough common sense. That must be God, because they're not that smart. And that's when God gets the glory. But when you start making it about yourself, that's when you lose focus. That's when you start getting disobedient, and that's when you need a consequence. Focus point for this morning. God's purpose is clear, and I avoid a harsh consequence when I submit myself to him through what, church? Obedience. Let's keep going. 1 Samuel chapter 11, verse 6. Here we go. Then the Spirit of God came powerfully upon Saul, and he became very angry. Let's pause right there. Why did Saul get angry? I'll tell y'all why he got angry. So check this out, right? In chapter 10 of 1 Samuel, Saul's heart changed. He started prophesying. He became this dude that God was using. The people were like, yes, he's our king. They had a big Saul rally, you know. They were chanting Saul, 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 right? And so chapter 11 comes around, and it's this big bad bully, right? His name is King Nahash of Amnon. And what happened with him, he was a bully. He was going around to these Israelite towns, and he was literally gouging out the right eye of everybody in every town. This dude was a total jerk. And so Saul's first assignment when he steps up to be king is he got to deal with this bully that's literally mutilating his people, taking out their right eye. And in that chapter 11, King Nahash said he was doing it to shame Israel. So Saul's like, I ain't going to let you do that, man. You can't hurt my people, and you ain't going to disrespect my God. So watch what happens with Saul. The Bible says Saul got very angry, right? Spirit of God came upon him. He gets angry. Look at verse 7. He took two oxen and cut them into pieces and sent the messengers to carry them throughout Israel with this message. This is what will happen to the oxen of anyone who refuses to follow Saul and Samuel in the battle. And the Lord made the people afraid of Saul's anger. Watch that. The Lord made the people afraid of Saul's anger. That's important because y'all are going to see this personality change happen in Saul. Some would say that there's a leader in our country who has like a personality disorder. He kind of like do stuff on social media, then he say one thing else and call stuff fake news and all that stuff. Well, Saul had some moments like that, probably some mental challenges with Saul. But his anger, he chopped up these animals and was like, if y'all don't follow me in the battle, I'm going to chop up all y'all animals. Oh, okay, we're ready, Saul. He was leading out of fear. Let me say this to all the leaders in the room. If you lead in any capacity, you lead in your home, you lead at your job, you lead in ministry, don't ever lead out of fear. If you have people following you out of fear, that will create a toxic and unhealthy environment where you always have to turn up to get results. If you don't rile up and do crazy stuff, then people ain't gonna take you seriously. That's why some of us parents in here, that's why some of the teachers struggle so much with your child in school, because your child is used to only listening when they get cussed out and beat up. So when the teacher talks to your child like a human being, your child says, F you, in chairs and getting out, they gotta keep calling you at work. Some of parents need to stop parenting and leading out of anger. We're gonna get to that a little bit later. Let's get back to the scriptures. Verse 8. When Saul mobilized them at Bezek, he found that there were 300,000 men from Israel and 30,000 men from Judah. I want y'all to understand that they were victorious in that battle, but I want to again point out to you, it was Saul's anger and the Lord made them afraid. Saul's anger and the Lord made them afraid. We'll come back to that. 1 Samuel chapter 13, verse 1. Saul was 30 years old when he became king, and he reigned for a long time, 42 years. In America, a president has a term of 4 years. And then if you get voted in again by the Electoral College, you get 4 more. So if you feel you're stuck with a president, you know, well, count down. You know, count on down. Okay. We made it through the Great Depression. We can make it through. You know, like we start thinking of like, okay, well, okay, shoot. Yeah, okay, they voting. Okay, 4 more years. Okay. But here, if it was a king, the king reigns until he died. So if you were a dysfunctional leader, you were just dysfunctional in destroying all your administration and destroying the people you're leading all the way till you die. 42 years of weirdness, 42 years of turning up, 42 years of leading people out of fear with the iron fist. Let's see what happens next. In chapter 10, Samuel gave Saul several instructions when he anointed him as king. One of them was for him to go to Gilgal and wait 7 days. How many days? 7 days, so that Samuel could offer a peace offering, right? And also a sacrificial offering, a burnt offering. What happens next is that Samuel rebukes Saul and tells him that he's disobedient. It's going to cost him the kingdom because he did not wait. He didn't wait on him 7 days. Saul saw Samuel wasn't there on the seventh day, and he's like, man, shoot, man, you know, it's getting late. I'm going to go ahead and burn up these offerings. Samuel rebuked Saul and said, because of this, your kingdom will not last forever. God is already raising up a new king who is a man after his own heart. That guy's going to be King David. We'll talk about him next week. So Saul starts getting a little turned up. He's like, what? Somebody else going to be ruling? I don't know if y'all saw Black Panther, right? But, you know, Killmonger, when Killmonger got the powers of, you know, the Black Panther, he was like, burn all that up. Ain't going to be no other king of Wakanda but me. How shallow-minded can you be? Of course you can't live forever, right? But some leaders lead with an iron fist. They're not thinking about the next generation. And some of us are like that in here too. We only think about ourselves. We get so self-absorbed. When God gives us a little platform, we take that little platform and we make it all about us. All the attention gets on us. Later on, Saul makes this foolish statement that anyone who eats before he kills his enemies will have to die. I'll say that again. Here we go. Okay, I told you the mental illness. Saul makes this statement. It's called Saul's foolish oath. He says, we're going to chase all my enemies down and kill them. And ain't none of y'all going to eat till we kill all of them. You will be hungry, bro. You know, like what type of sense does that make? They didn't have guns back then. You needed a certain level of energy and strength to lift your shield and lift the sword, right, to cut through somebody's flesh. He's telling them, y'all ain't eating nothing till they all dead. Now, how can your army survive without rations, without eating, without drinking? Like, it doesn't make any sense. So now we catch up to the story. Saul has disobeyed God. He didn't wait for Samuel for 7 days. He said, I'm going to offer up these offerings on my own, cuz. Samuel says, you know what? You ain't going to be the king forever no more. And when what that statement means is your kingdom won't last forever. In other words, his genealogy, his son won't reign, and his son won't reign, and his son won't reign. God's going to remove your whole family from the kingdom and bring in a new dude. That's cold. And so on top of that, he starts turning up and says, all right, okay. But while I'm king, I'm going to be like Killmonger. And he just starts wilding out. None of y'all going to eat till we kill all of them. Let's go. But the problem is his son Jonathan didn't hear him make this oath. Watch what happens in the story. Jonathan was out there killing the enemies and didn't hear his dad make this real stupid decision. So Jonathan got hungry. He dipped the bottom of his stick in some honey and ate it. And he felt refreshed and he kept fighting. Let's get to the scriptures. 1 Samuel chapter 14, verse 43. They cast lots, which means it was a spiritual way of shooting dice. Yes, a spiritual way of shooting dice. When they say casting lots, they shot dice. And they prayed, and the lot would fall on someone. So they cast lots, and the numbers fell on Saul and his son. And then he said, which one of us did something wrong before the Lord? They shot the dice or casted lots, and the lot fell on Jonathan. And now Saul says in verse 43, tell me what you've done, Jonathan. I tasted a little honey, Jonathan admitted. It was only a little bit on the end of my stick. Does that deserve death? Yes, Jonathan. Whoa, Dad. What? You gonna kill me? Jonathan was his top soldier, but forget that, he's his son. This guy was ruling with such an iron fist. He was willing to kill his own son to prove a point. Verse 44, yes, Jonathan said, you must, I'm sorry, yes, Jonathan, Saul said, you must die. May God strike me and even kill me if you do not die for this. Somebody say, wildin'. Verse 45, but the people broke in and said to Saul, Jonathan has won this great victory for Israel. Should he die? Should he die? Far from it. As surely as the Lord lives, not one hair on his head will be touched, for God helped him to do a great deed today. So the people rescued Jonathan, and he was not put to death, but they rescued Jonathan from his own father. You thought your political leader had problems. Lesson number four out of our six lessons for today. Lesson number four, I must lead or parent with compassion. Come on, parents. Come on, leaders. If you are in upper management or leadership at your job, come on. I must lead or parent with what, church? Compassion. Instead of being strong and wrong about an issue. Look, just apologize. Just admit that it wasn't a wise choice. I apologize to my leaders in this church all the time. Why? Because I'm not a perfect pastor. And if any pastor tells you he's perfect, he's lying or she's lying. We are going to make mistakes as parents. Any kids in here can tell you, yeah, don't raise your hand too high, though. Your dad's in here. But, like, your parents make poor choices. Being strong and wrong about an issue only causes a wider gap in trust between the people you love and the children you parent. Saul was strong and wrong. He put it out there, and instead of just apologizing, like somebody on social media, you try to make it about everybody else. This guy was like, yeah, I had all these people at my inauguration. I had all these people. No, you didn't.
Yeah, it was fake news, yeah.
Dude, there's photos. They photoshopped it. No, you're just wrong. Why can't you just admit to being wrong? Being strong and wrong about an issue does not help people trust you. Learn that lesson from King Saul, ladies and gentlemen. Our focus point for today, if you don't remember anything else we talk about, our focus point is this. God's purpose is clear, and I avoid a harsh consequence when I submit myself to him through what, church? In the Old Testament, God dealt with sin somewhat differently than the way he deals with it today. See, back in the day, in the Old Testament, people literally died, physically died. Now today, people spiritually die, and then they physically die. What I mean is this. If the Amalekites were worshiping another god, and they were sinning and trying to enslave Israel, God would say, go kill all of them. See, the Amalekites sinned against God's people hundreds of years ago from this point that we are in history, back when Moses was on earth. When Moses was leading the people from the land of Egypt, the Amalekites refused to help the Israelites, and God didn't forget about it. So now we fast forward a few hundred years into the future. We're still in the Old Testament, but now they got their first king, and God says, I'm going to deal with those Amalekites for not helping my people when those evil people in Egypt had enslaved them. So here's what God told them. God said, go and kill all the Amalekites. Go and take all their possessions and destroy them. All right, I'm going to say it again. God said, kill all the Amalekites and destroy all their possessions. Kill all the people, destroy their possessions. Kill all the people, destroy their possessions. God went pretty gangster back in the Old Testament. He was like the Godfather. God put hits out on people. How many of y'all are thankful now for God's grace? Because God still loves, and God loved those people too. But God gave the Amalekites and Egyptians and all these other people so many chances to serve him. When they didn't, he said, I'm going to wipe them off the planet. Now, when people turn their backs on God, he doesn't necessarily wipe them off the planet. But what happens is people spiritually die, where they walk around not understanding purpose, not understanding their life, and they're spiritual zombies walking around on earth, physical bodies, but spiritually empty. And it takes for the believers, us, to share the gospel with people, to revive them, to rejuvenate them, that they would have a rebirth or be born again with a new life in Christ Jesus. I thank God for the New Testament or the New Covenant. I'm so glad I wasn't living back in the Old Covenant. But here we are in the Old Covenant. Let's get to the next passage of Scripture. 1 Samuel chapter 15. Y'all stay with me? 1 Samuel chapter 15. Saul was supposed to kill King Agag. and destroy all his possessions. Look what Saul did. Saul and his men spared Agag's life and kept the best of the sheep and goats, the cattle, the fat calves, and the lambs. Everything, in fact, that appealed to them. Have you ever held on to something that appealed to you that God told you to let go of? How about a relationship? How about a material possession? How about some interest in your thought process? God told him to cut it off. Maybe God's told you to cut somebody off. Not physically cut them, but to cut them off from communication because they're not healthy for you. To destroy the memories of that thing or those people, but you held on to a little bit of it. A little something to remember by, a little Polaroid, a little picture, a little something. In the iPhone, they got these hidden photos. And so what you can do is you can take a picture of something, you can hide it so it doesn't come up in your album. And so what the Bible wants us to understand is that God told him to destroy everything, but he kept the dude Agag to gloat over, and he took all the stuff that appealed to him. Let's keep going. They destroyed only what was worthless or of poor quality. Verse 10. Then the Lord said to Samuel, I am sorry that I ever made Saul king, for he has not been loyal to me and has refused to obey my command. Refused to obey my command. Refused to obey my command. Somebody say, I have a choice. See, God always gives us choices. But we have a choice whether we're going to obey or what? Disobey. Samuel was so deeply moved when he heard this that he cried out to the Lord all night. Here's our fifth lesson out of six. Here's lesson number five. Partial obedience is disobedience. If you had a strict parent like I did, if your mama told you to wash the dishes and mop the floor, and you only wash the dishes, you were disobedient. Anybody had parents like that, grandmama like that? If they told you to do a list of things, you can't just do half of it. It's all or what? Nothing. So what happened? Here's the consequence for disobedience. 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 12. Early the next morning, Samuel went to find Saul. Someone told him Saul went to the town of Carmel to set up a monument to himself. Now this dude is egotistical now. First he's being disobedient. Secondly, he's leading out of anger. Now he's so arrogant. He went to a town to build a monument to himself? Some type of statue or shrine of himself? This dude's leadership is going way left field. Then he went to Gilgal. Verse 13, when Samuel finally found him, Saul greeted him cheerfully. May the Lord bless you, he said. I have carried out the Lord's command. Now, didn't we just read in the last passage that God said he refused to obey my command? But in Saul's eyes, he has obeyed God's command. This leads us to our final lesson for today, which is this. Pride and self-deception go hand in hand. He builds a monument to himself, and then he deceives himself thinking that he's done what God wants him to do. Have you ever tricked yourself? Have you ever told yourself a lie so much that you began to believe it? You've convinced yourself that this is good for you, although you know it's not. You know this person is not good for you. You know this habit is not good for you. You know this place, this environment is not healthy for you, but you tell yourself, oh, I'm going to be all right this time. Or God forgave me last time, so I know he got me this time. We begin to rationalize and make excuses for things we're about to do. Saul is delusional now, and he tells the prophet Samuel that he has done what the Lord told him to do. Here's our last passage, and we're done for today. 1 Samuel 15, 22. But Samuel replied, what is more pleasing to the Lord, your burnt offerings and sacrifices, or your obedience to his voice? That's a good question. What's more important? Your apologies after the fact, or your obedience and follow through with what he tells you? See, offering burnt sacrifices is basically the Old Testament way of apologizing. They get an animal and kill it, put it on the altar and burn it before the Lord, and that was their apology to God. God accepts our apologies, but he wants us to understand it's better to not have to apologize. It's better to be obedient. Listen, obedience is better than sacrifice. Obedience is better than your apologies. Obedience is better than your excuses. And submission is better than offering the fat of rams. Rebellion is as sinful as witchcraft, and stubbornness as bad as worshiping idols. When you're not listening to God, when you shut off God, like being stubborn to what God wants you to do, that's like worshiping an idol. Why? Why, Pastor Devin? Because you want that thing more than you want him. It's that simple. We make idols all the time. We judge the people in the Old Testament for carving out wooden statues and making these metal gods. But we have social media gods we worship all the time. We have images in people we follow on these flat screen devices that get our attention and want our allegiance. They want us to follow their trend. We hashtag it. God, we hashtag things to follow them. And I'm not trying to diss social media holistically, but I think you get my point. If you don't, listen closely. Social media is not a sin, but if you put social media and what social media wants of you above what God wants of you, it's an idol. And our God is jealous. And he wants your obedience. It's better than your apologies. And the best part is, you don't have to deal with the consequences for making those poor choices. How many reprimands do you need? How many timeouts from God do you need? How many relationships have to go bad do you need? How many bills do you have to keep stacking up that you need for you to understand that you have made an idol out of shopping and spending to get your emotions in a certain euphoric vibe? That your brain releases this chemical of euphoria when you're shopping. You have made shopping something you run to instead of God to your problems. So because you have rejected the command of the Lord, he has rejected you as king. We're going to pick up on King Saul next week and go into King David. It gets worse for King Saul. My hope for you is that yours doesn't have to get worse before it gets better, ladies and gentlemen. That you don't continue to go through disobedience in your life and have to face these harsh consequences. So you may say, Pastor Devin, I hear you, man. I don't want to keep going down this path. How do I apply this message to my life? How do I take this one step further in my spiritual journey? Here's our next steps, and then we'll pray. Ask God to reveal to you the areas in your life where you're being disobedient to him. Ask him for forgiveness and to help you walk in obedience. Let's stand to our feet if we can. Father God, we come before you right now in the name of Jesus Christ, and God, we just ask for forgiveness for the disobedience, for the things that we know that we shouldn't have been doing, the interactions that we know we shouldn't have been having. This is a new year, God, but to be honest, some of us have been living with the same hang-ups from last year, still making the same poor choices from last year. But God, we want to bring a change today. We ask not only for your forgiveness, Father God, we ask for your help to help strengthen us, to guide us, to lead us into your good, pleasing, and perfect will. And God, we ask and pray that you would help us to remember that your purpose is clear, and that we can avoid a harsh consequence when we submit ourselves to you through obedience. We pray this prayer in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Amen.